Hello and welcome to today's book reading session of Preparing for the Day After. Preparing for the Day After is a photojournalistic treatise on disaster mitigation published by me, Malini Shankar, and Walter Keller for the 10th anniversary of the Asian tsunami. Tonight we will study culture-sensitive food security in disaster-struck landscapes. Let us first recap what we have learned in the previous book reading session before we start tonight's reading session. Water and sanitation, food and livelihood security have to be part of the development paradigm. Water and sanitation infrastructure has to be of uncompromising standards and inclusive of the needs of differently abled people in disaster shelters. Toilets in disaster shelters have to be cleansed and sanitized on an hourly basis. As many toilets have to be constructed on a per capita basis, not serving the needs of more than 5 people per day. Separate toilets for differently abled persons must have enough room for a wheelchair-bound person. There have to be railings to aid the wheelchair-bound person to use the toilet. Automatic flushing systems and automatic sanitizing of toilet seat rims are necessary in toilets meant exclusively for differently abled people. Shower cubicles must be accessible for differently abled persons. Soap dispensers and shower control knobs must be compatible to people seated on a wheelchair. As much automation is required as possible in these toilets. Just imagine the needs of a quadriplegic who does not have human assistance. So deploying structural engineering gadgets like robots to the aid of the quadriplegics is a goal to strive for. If we achieve that, we attain the sustainable development goal number 10, to reduce inequalities. To achieve this, the Central Census and Social Welfare Department have to keep updated records for differently abled persons and enumerate their needs for automation. You see the need for transparent governance here? Thus, to achieve optimization of water supply and sanitation, that is SDG number 6, SDG stands for Sustainable Development Goals. Number 6, we need transparent governance, which is the sum total of all the SDGs. Industrial enterprise and SDG 9 include industry, innovation and infrastructure. Transparent governance means not only corruption-free administration but a digitized version of all the factors of development and sustainable development goals. These include eliminating poverty, eliminating hunger, good health, well-being, access to public health, quality education, gender equality, clean water and sanitation, affordable and clean energy, decent work and economic growth, industry, innovation and infrastructure, reduced inequalities, sustainable cities and communities, responsible consumption and production, climate action, ocean health, life on land, peace, justice and strong institutions, meaning transparent governance and partnership for goals. Scientific installations like Doppler radars, satellite imagery, early warning installations, GIS mapping, water supply bladders, desalination plants, tide gauges, seismeters, tsunami buoys, etc. have to be well maintained to take cognizance of rapid developments in the field of hydrometeorology. These can also take cognizance of hidden treasures like traditional wisdom. Media must take proactive steps in scrutinizing public assets like telecom and ITES infrastructure, maintenance of dams and reservoirs, railways, hospitals and healthcare, and so on. Scrutiny of disaster preparedness in aviation, shipping and public transport is a tenet whose time has come. There are no safety instructions before helicopters take off, at least in India. There are no wheelchairs made available in helipads in India for helicopter passengers. Neither are there toilets in helicopters. Culture-sensitive food security is a concept that implies cultural conformity to agrometeorological conditions or evolution of food consumption, synchronous to agrometeorological conditions in people's culture. If disaster management is all about lessons learned from the previous disasters, there is room to believe that India has not learned lessons about distribution of culture-sensitive food aid during the disaster mitigation phase of the post-Uttarakhand floods in June 2013 from the biggest of all disasters, the Asian tsunami. Cooked food is generally available to survivors only for a few days to a couple of weeks maximum in a post-disaster situation. The idea is to help them become independent and self-reliant as soon as possible. After the administration After that, the administration normally moves to providing uncooked food. In a country or a subcontinent as varied as Indian culinary heritage, cultural heritage has derived from agro-meteorological conditions. Add the complex matrix of caste divisions and it is already a nightmare. Then there are approximately 16 to 20 varieties of green leafy vegetables available in one district, and India has 604 districts. There are seasonal fruits, but in myriad varieties. The middle latitudes given to dry, hot weather make ideal ground for production of millets. Coastal humidity supports biodiversity, giving agriculture the genetic link for food production. Given the agro-meteorological conditions that favor agro-diversity across the subcontinent, it is no surprise that food diversity is part of our culture. Let us take a look at the traditional foods across South Asia. The challenge in providing cooked food to disaster survivors lies in pleasing their palate, providing logistics for food distribution while conforming to nutritional index. All said, nutrition experts aver that food intake has to be directly proportional to labor discharge per day. Thus, fishers, construction laborers, road construction laborers, municipal workers, agricultural laborers will be justified in asking for a complete carbohydrate-based meal. Then you add religious convictions like vegetarianism for Brahmins and other upper castes, or halal meat for Muslims and food without garlic, onions or tubers for the Jains, and it's a perfect nightmare for the cooks in the disaster mitigation team in disaster shelters. Not to be forgotten is the possibility of diabetics in the disaster shelter. There will be people with other dietary restrictions on health grounds too in the shelters. Landlubbers like us, wedded to the comfort of the Internet of Things, barely need a few shots of vitamins or calories to sustain us for a few hours long, if we want to retain a healthy lifestyle, that is. Let me first dwell on the logistics of food transport to provide culture-sensitive food. Disaster shelters must be ideally located on a per capita basis in disaster-prone areas. In a subcontinent like India, different areas are prone to multiple disasters. Hydrometeorological disasters in themselves include avalanches, blizzards, cloudbursts, coastal incursions, cyclones, drought, desertification, El Niño's southern oscillation and its differential impacts, epidemics, floods, flash floods, famine, forest fires, fog, landslides, mudslides, sea surge, storms, urban floods, and so on. Then you have geological calamities like earthquakes, liquefaction of subsoil, seismic and volcano-induced landslides, tsunamis and volcanoes. Sometimes one calamity has a series of interchanging impacts in one region itself. Secondary disasters are common in places struck by natural calamities. For example, a flood brings in its wake waterborne diseases among survivors. Due to heavy rainfall, I shall wait for the slideshow of the hydrometeorological disasters to finish.
That's liquefaction. That's a seismic induced landslide. That's a tsunami. A tsunami is damage. And then you have volcanoes.
Sometimes one calamity has a series of interchanging impacts in one region itself. Secondary disasters are common in places struck by natural calamities. For example, a flood brings in its wake waterborne diseases among survivors. Due to heavy rainfall, there can be a menace of mosquitoes in pools of stagnant water, leading to breeding of mosquitoes. This causes dengue, chikungunya, and so on. There have been many pandemics since the dawn of the new millennium. Since the year 2000, there were SARS, MERS, dengue, chikungunya, hepatitis and its various versions, H1N5, H1N1, H1N9, and so on. Swine flu and bird flu and all the variants of flu, including the coronaviruses, have had variants breaking out regionally. The Spanish flu, swine flu outbreak, Russian flu, H1N1 pandemic, India outbreak, Maldives outbreak, Myanmar outbreak, Pakistan outbreak, Malta outbreak, Morocco outbreak, Iran outbreak have been listed by the World Health Organization. Disasters have a way of being linked from cause to consequence. Anticipating the consequence is the realm of the experts. Disaster shelters must have warehousing facilities to stockpile food rations with refrigeration if appropriate, and this food supply has to be computed on a per capita basis. Now, coming to food supply in disaster shelters itself, vegetarianism is the norm, as we have already learned, in disaster shelters, because none can be offended as regards religious and other sentimental reasons. Food supply depends on logistics and warehousing. Indian food is largely cooked. Raw foods like salads are not very popular in India. Lastly, we ought to consider the different food traditions in South Asian nations. Afghanistan relishes its different breads. Pakistan thrives on meat curry and basmati rice. Indian foods lack homogeneity, but that is the charm of the gastronomical variety in the subcontinent. Sri Lanka relishes coconut gratings as well as coconut milk in lentil soup, in rice cooking as well as in vegetable servings. Myanmar and Vietnam thrive on rice broth, while Thailand and Indonesia builds on different varieties of rice, vegetables, sprouts, lentils, beef and meats. I have put together a slideshow of South Asian staple foods, not just to make it appeasing, but to show you how difficult it will be to cater to all palates in disaster shelters and disaster-prone Southeast Asia. Given all these factors, it makes sense to plan meals based on a nutrition index on the following lines. Plant protein options for breakfast, including sprouts, fruits, a glass of milk, and stimulants like tea or coffee. Calorie calibrated lunch, including two slices of bread or equivalent, like two chapatis with a vegetable based side dish, one cup of fresh vegetable salad, one cup of red rice or unpolished rice variety, a bowl of vegetable broth like sambar made with lentils and vegetables or a soup bowl, a cup of tea or coffee with either roasted peanuts or dry fruits in the evening. Supper or dinner must include a buffet of boiled vegetables, vegetable soup, soup sticks, fruit bowl, and either a bowl of red rice or unpolished rice or two slices of whole wheat bread or chapatis. Variation in food can be introduced on a weekly basis to break the monotony. But care must be taken to ensure that sensitivities like religious convictions or health factors are heeded. Volunteers in the task force must enumerate in a separate checklist factors like allergies, food choices, etc. to be submitted to the district administration. After a couple of weeks of food supply, the state and relief agencies resort to supplying dry food rations. This helps the surviving community regain a sense of self-reliance on the one hand. After a couple of weeks of food supply, the state and relief agencies resort to supplying dry food rations. This helps the surviving community regain a sense of self-reliance on the one hand and the freedom to cook and eat what they want. But minimal infrastructure like gas stoves, utensils, cooking oils, spices and cooking ingredients are needed, at least as a common property resource in temporary shelters. This was successfully executed in the temporary shelters for the survivors of the Kashmir earthquake in October 2005. There is also the factor of traditional wisdom. During my research tour of Odisha, I met tribal women in 2 to 3 districts of the state. They said they were unable to get rice in the aftermath of the cyclone Phaelan in October 2013. So to mitigate malnutrition, they adapted by making millet porridge for children and infants and for the youngsters. Food rations have to be procured from the nearest production center, be it an agricultural field or agricultural produce market. Bringing basmati rice from Punjab or Jammu in Kashmir to a disaster shelter in Orissa is not practical. Though the food aid was in part rejected by the Asian tsunami survivors amongst the fisher community in Tamil Nadu, lessons were not quite learned. It was very chivalrous on the part of the sardars who came down with stove, flour and all to make rotis with dal and sabji or dry vegetable side dish on a massive scale. But the fishers wanted rice and fish curry. Some survivors of the tsunami I met clarified that they rejected only stale, fungus-ridden bread and spoiled milk. They did not reject freshly made chapatis with dal. But in the aftermath of the Uttarakhand flash floods in 2013, disaster managers cooked up rice dishes made with all the spices and vegetables plus lentils, which was rejected on the grounds that they lacked garlic and mint, which are very widely used in North Indian cuisine. That is why the Central Food Technology Research Institute of Central Scientific and Industrial Research Council of the Government of India had proposed in the aftermath of the Asian tsunami that the government establishes 22 regional hubs across India to store food rations and have the logistics ready for rapid cooking and dispersal of regional food to the disaster zone as quickly as possible. Such regional hubs will be the practical solution to catering culture-sensitive food security to calamity survivors. For example, jackfruit is a food security crop in itself. It grows in tropical zones in India. The biggest jackfruit was found to be 5 kilos in weight. Rich in fiber, complex carbs, filling, sumptuous and tasty. Besides being homegrown and easy to harvest from the neighborhood, it is practically a one-fruit-suits-all source of food, ideal for breakfast in disaster shelters. Similarly, if there is a Himalayan landslide, let's try and source our foods from the vicinity. Star fruit, strawberry, citron, lychee, etc. instead of jackfruit and muskmelon should be the ideal choice. The state can also assign disaster refugees to pick or pluck the fruit for a daily wage. That is then a source of livelihood subsidy for the survivors in the shelters. Similarly, disaster refugees in the shelters can be assigned the responsibility for bringing in vegetables, roots and tubers and rations or herbs, green leafy vegetables found in the vicinity. They can also volunteer in the disaster shelter. There are ways to earn livelihood subsidy which will help survivors regain a sense of self-reliance and a sense of moral responsibility. It is also a means of training the next generation of volunteers for the next disaster from the community itself. One size does not fit all in matters of gastronomy. Protocols need to be established in accordance with agrometeorological traditions, the palate factor, available logistics, food rations, the labor factor, public health, religious convictions, etc. In case you have any constructive suggestions for culture-sensitive food security, I request you all to please write in your suggestions. That said, diabetics and allied endocrine disorders like hypertension and hyperthyroidism are assuming pandemic proportions around the world. Attention needs to be given to regulating our diet to preventing gastronomical public health disasters. Diabetes does not just claim the price of good health, but productivity and fiscal fallout are surefire results of mass amputations and resultant public health chaos from diabetes mellitus. That lecture is for another day. That is all we have for today. Hope you find it interesting. In the next week's episode, we will learn about COVID-compatible architecture. Please do log in for a live interactive chat from around 7:30 p.m. Indian time on Saturday, 17th of April 2021 for an interaction about culture-sensitive food security. Until then, keep smiling, take care, and ciao!